Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Hello. So in this module, we will extend the approach that we have developed for the simple problem with two unit processes to the original problem that we had started with. That was the problem of a toaster life cycle. So if you remember, we had started with that problem, and when the issue of interconnection between two unit processes came, that's when we shifted to the matrix approach. So let us revisit that problem now. So let us now go back to this problem where the technology matrix has to be written. So this was the original problem that we started with. This is still the simpler problem without the interconnections between the technology, between the steel and steam production steps. But I want you to now write the technology matrix for this problem. So the process here is we identify the various unit processes and product flows and then write the technology matrix. So let us see. So there are five unit processes here. You have steel manufacturing, steam production, toaster production, toaster use, and toaster disposal. These are the five unit processes, okay, in this product system. What are the different product flows? Let us see those. The different product flows in this system are steel, which is produced by the first unit process of steel manufacturing, steam, which is produced by steam production process, toaster, which is produced by the toaster production process, toasted bread. So this is not explicitly shown here, but you are actually using the toaster to make breads or toast bread. So that is something that is being generated. It is not shown explicitly here, but that is also a product flow. And the final is the use toaster, which goes into the disposal process, which connects the user phase or user stage to the disposal stage. So these are the five product flows. Now, given this information, can we now write the technology matrix? So let us see how we can write that. So this is the process. This is the matrix without the numbers. So let us see how we can fill this matrix. So all the columns are the unit processes, as I have shown, five unit processes. All the rows are product flows. So let us start writing the numbers here. Let us go by unit process wise. So steel manufacturing produces 1 kg of steel. Okay, so this will be 1. Okay, and it doesn't relate to any other product flow. So there is no steam generation in the steel manufacturing process. So this will be 0. There is no toaster production in steel manufacturing, no toasted breads, and of course no used toaster. So all the other coefficients will be 0. Matrix elements will be 0. What about steam production? So steam production produces steam. Okay, it doesn't produce anything else. It doesn't connect to any other product flow. So again, the number will be 1 and everything else will be 0. Now this is again could be a point of confusion. Why should this be 1? Because if you look at the product system that is given to you, it tells you that for the production of the toaster, you need only 0.5 megajoules of steam. You don't need 1 megajoule of steam. So why should we have 1 here and not 0.5? And the answer again is that if you remember, the technology matrix captures the performance of the technology. So your emission data is given for per megajoule of steam. It says 4 kg of CO2 per megajoule of steam, and therefore your information is given for 1 megajoule, and therefore you should use 1 here. So where is that 0.5 captured? That 0.5 is captured in the column for toaster production. Now here toaster production requires steel, and it generates a toaster. So it uses 1 kg of steel, and because it is an input to the toaster production step, it is minus 1. Toaster production step also requires 0.5 megajoule of steam. So it will again be minus 0.5, minus because it's an input. And it generates one toaster. Okay, so that's why one with a positive coefficient, because it is coming out of the toaster production step. And all the other things are zero. Now what about toaster use? In toaster use, there is no direct connection with steel manufacturing or steam production, so those are zero. Toaster use phase has an input of one toaster. So once the toaster is manufactured by the toaster production phase, it goes to the use phase. So it's an input to the use phase, so that's why this will be minus one. And how many toasts you are getting out of the use phase? 1000. So our functional unit is 1000 toasts, that is the lifetime of the toaster use. So it's the output is 1000 and it's for positive 1000. And after the use phase, it generates a used toaster which cannot work anymore. So there is an output of 1, and because it's an output, it's plus 1. So see here is that in the use phase, 1 toaster goes in, negative sign, you get 1000 toasts out during the use phase, and at the end of the use phase you get one used toaster. Okay, so that is the approach here. Now in the disposal phase, the coefficients will be 0 0. The only thing that is going into the disposal phase is a used toaster, so it will have a minus 1 sign here. Okay, so this is how you construct a technology matrix. Now we can also construct the environmental intervention matrix. Okay, so the environmental intervention matrix here is going to be relatively simple, and let's see how we can do that. So again, you have 5 different stages. So you have steel manufacturing, you have steam production, you have toaster production, you have toaster use, and toaster disposal. And here, as per the rules, the number of rows is equal to number of impact categories. Now here the problem was only about CO2 emissions, so there is going to be only one row. So now you have to go back to the information that was given to you. So this is your matrix B. So the steel manufacturing, for 1 kg of steel, it generates 1 kg of CO2, so this will be 1. For 1 kg of steam, 1 megajoule of steam, it generates 4 kgs of CO2, so this will be 1, this will be 4. For manufacturing of 1 toaster, it generates 2 kgs of CO2, so this will be 2. During the use phase, number of breads toasted are 1000, right? And for every bread, the emission is 0.001. So 0.001 is so many kgs per toast, and you generate, you can make 1000 toasts. So this becomes 1. Okay, so again this will be 1. And the disposal phase, for disposing of 1 toaster, you generate 0.5 kgs of CO2. So this is your environmental intervention matrix. And this was your technology matrix. Once you have A and B, now you can do the calculations. So this is an example of how you can create a technology and environmental intervention matrix. Now let us see how will the matrix change if you have this modified problem. This was actually the beginning of the discussion on the matrix approach, and we said that there is going to be a recycle here. So this, or at least the interconnection. So steel production requires steam, steam production requires steel. How do you account for this? Now given the discussion, now this is going to be fairly straightforward. This is again similar to the simpler example that we had looked at. But let us see how we can make that modification. So this was the original technology matrix without the interconnection between steam and steel production. So the way this will change now is there will be just two modifications. What we are saying now is that steam steel manufacturing requires steam. So here you will have some modifications. So this column corresponds, the first column corresponds to steel manufacturing, this one. So it produces 1 kg of steel, but in order to do that it requires 0.5 megajoule of steam, and therefore it will be minus 0.5, minus because it's an input. So that will be one change. The second change will be for steam production, because steam production requires some steel. That number again is 0.5, so this will again be minus 0.5. Okay, so if you look at this column now, steam production, it says that we need 0.5 kgs of steel and it generates 1 megajoule of steam. The first column says that we need 0.5 megajoules of steam and we generate 1 kg of steel. So it captures the information. Nothing else will change because there is no change in the other unit processes, and similarly the environmental intervention matrix will also not change. So the important learning outcomes of this specific module are that there are standardized rules for formulating the technology and the environmental intervention matrices, and it is, if you use the standard approaches, it becomes easy to handle recycle. There are standard methods available to solve a set of linear algebraic equations, simultaneous linear algebraic equations. Those methods can be used whether there is a recycle or not. So that's a big advantage of using the matrix approach. So we will conclude the discussion on the matrix approach here. You can practice this by creating your own problems, identify a problem from literature, and see if you can create the technology or the environmental intervention matrix. Many software also, when you develop a product system in a software, they'll actually show the environmental intervention and the technology matrix to you. In this module, let us continue the discussion on the matrix approach used for inventory calculations. We have already seen the method and 2 examples. So here, let us take another example and work on developing the technology and the environmental intervention matrix. So let me explain the problem first. So here the problem is related to power generation. So this figure shows the product system that is of interest. The problem here is that there are 3 different power plants. So there is a coal based power plant which is called as PP_coal. There is an oil based power plant which is called as PP_oil, and there is a gas based power plant which is using natural gas as an input. So there are 3 different power plants, and we are provided information related to the resources that they are using, as well as the CO2 emissions that they are generating for every kilowatt hour of power that is generated. And there is a 4th component in this product system, which is the electricity grid. Now this electricity grid essentially mixes the power produced by these individual power plants and provides a common electricity to for further use. So this situation is actually very similar to what we typically have in national power grids. If you look at any national power grid, there would be power plants based on various sources like coal, natural gas, oil, also some renewable plants like hydro, wind and so on, and they will contribute their electricity to a grid which then provides the electricity to the consumer. If you go to life cycle inventory databases also, they will have an emission inventory for a typical power grid for a particular nation. So this is a very common situation that comes in power grid calculations. So here the system is such that coal based power plant, in addition to the coal input, also requires some electricity, and that electricity is actually provided from the mixed grid. So that's why you have this recycle. So every kilowatt hour of power that is generated by the coal based power plant requires 0.5 kilowatt hours of electricity, and that electricity is the mixed electricity, or the electricity from the grid. So that is captured by this recycle. So now the question here is, I want you to calculate the technology and the environmental intervention matrix for this problem. So if it is possible, please pause this video for a few minutes and attempt the problem by writing the technology matrix A and the environmental intervention matrix B. So the first thing when you start writing the technology or the environmental intervention matrix is to find out the number of unit processes and which unit processes are there and the number of product flows, because that will decide the size of your matrices. So the first thing here is to find out the number of unit processes. Here there are four different unit processes. Three unit processes correspond to the three power plants that you see here in the system, and the fourth one is the mixing of these electricity, or this mixing of electricity from different sources, and we call it as EE underscore grid or PP underscore grid. Okay, so these are the four different unit processes that we have in the system. Now the next thing we need to find are the number of product flows. The number of product flows here are four, and let me explain that. So here the four product flows that you have in your system are the four electricity streams. So I am calling it as EE underscore coal, EE underscore oil, EE underscore gas, and EE underscore grid, and they represent the source of the electricity. It is important to note here that although these four are electricities, they are not the same, because they are not produced by the same unit process. They are produced by different unit processes, and therefore they need to be considered as different product flows. And this is an important point to note here, that the same category of flow or the same type of material doesn't necessarily mean that the product flow is same. So here you have these three electricities generated and the common or the mixed electricity that is generated. These are the four product flows. Another point I want to highlight here is that we are not considering these three inputs as product flows, because the assumption here is that this is coming from nature. So you are taking coal, oil or gas from nature, or it is coming from outside the system. It is not part of the system boundary. If I consider it as a product flow for my life cycle inventory calculations, then I will have to consider it. I will also have to consider the unit process that generates these product flows, and that information is not given, and therefore we are considering these as resources consumed, and therefore they will come in the environmental intervention matrices. Okay. Now we also know the product flow, so we have four unit processes and four product flows. That means your technology matrix A will be a 4x4 matrix. The number of impacts or the emissions or resources consumed, the number of such types are again four. Three resources that are consumed: coal, oil and natural gas, and CO2 emissions. So your environmental intervention matrix will also be a 4x4 matrix. Now given this background, let us now see how the matrix itself will be written. So as I have already discussed, we have identified the number of product system, number of unit processes and the product flows. So that is already written here. So now once you have decided these the size of the matrix and the columns and rows, the rest of the procedure is fairly straightforward. You have to look at the information given and fill out these numbers. So if you look at first column, which is the column corresponding to coal based electricity production, it generates 1 kilowatt hour of electricity. Okay, that information is given to you. It doesn't have any connection with coal, with oil or gas based electricity production, therefore those coefficients will be zero. And this first coal based electricity production process or that power plant also takes an input of 0.5 kilowatt hour from the mixed grid electricity, and therefore this will be minus because it will have it is an input to the system. So I hope this point is clear to you, that it is an input to the system and therefore negative, and 0.5 kilowatt hour is the information given. So that is about the first product system. The second product system, which second unit process, which is PP oil, produces 1 kilowatt hour of electricity, which is the EE oil electricity. So this will be 0, 1, 0 and 0. There is no recycle for the oil based power plant. The steps for the gas based power plant are also same. So you'll have 0, 0, 1 because it is producing 1 kilowatt hour of gas based electricity, and 0 again. And PP grid is actually taking input from all the three different power plants. So this will have non-zero numbers, minus 0.3 because the contribution is 0.3 from coal-based electricity, minus 0.6 because the contribution is 0.6 from coal-based electricity, oil-based electricity. For gas-based, it is going to be minus 0.1. So these are all the inputs, and it is generating 1 kilowatt hour. So these are the inputs to the mixing process, and that's why they are negative, and this is the output, 1 kilowatt hour. So this is now our technology matrix. It's a 4 cross 4 matrix, and we have populated the matrix with the corresponding numbers. Now let us look at the environmental intervention matrix. So here I have already said that it's a 4 cross 4 matrix. There are 4 unit processes, and there are 4 impacts that we are interested in: coal, oil, gas and CO2. So, and this information is also given to you. In order to produce 1 kilowatt hour of electricity by coal, it requires 5 kgs of coal. So it will be 5 here, and of course you'll have a minus sign because it's an input. There is no oil consumption by the coal-based power plant. There is no gas consumption by coal-based power plant, and therefore these will be zero. There is CO2 emission. We are told that every kilowatt hour of coal-based electricity generation generates 15 kgs of CO2. So that's why this number will be 15. If you have understood this logic, there the numbers for the rest, the remaining two power plants can be determined. So you'll have 0 here because there is no coal consumption by oil based power plant. The amount of oil consumed is 3 kg, and therefore it will be minus 3 here, 0. And the CO2 generation is 9 kgs of CO2 per kilowatt hour. So that's why it will be 9. For the gas based power plant, the corresponding numbers will be 0, 0, minus 1 and 3. This again is based on the information that is given. And for the grid, there is no resource consumption. The grid or the mixing process is not actually taking any coal, natural gas or oil. So these numbers will be zero. And there is also no CO2 generation. So the actual mixing process, it is assumed here, doesn't emit any CO2. So this will also be this zero. So this whole column for PP grid, as far as environmental impact is concerned, is zero. So this basically means that that mixing process doesn't have any environmental impact. So this is your environmental intervention matrix. Now remember that when we wrote these technology and environmental intervention matrices, we did not need to know the functional unit. So I have not yet defined what should be the functional unit. But that doesn't matter because as I have already pointed out, the technology and environmental intervention matrices are independent of the functional unit. So you can use these matrices A and B that we have just formulated for any functional unit that is given to you. So this was another example that I solved in order to further emphasize the mathematics or the matrix approach behind the inventory calculation. So with the help of these multiple problems, I expect that the concept of matrix operations for inventory calculation would have been, you would have understood that those concepts. In the last few modules, we have looked at the life cycle inventory calculations in fair amount of details, and we have understood the matrix approach for performing life cycle inventory calculations. Following on in this module, I will discuss a very important topic related to inventory calculations, which is the topic of impact allocation. So let me start by giving the motivation. And the motivation is that when you are doing life cycle assessment studies, you often encounter situations where a unit process is generating multiple products, or a product system is generating multiple products. And one very good example from chemical engineering domain is a petrochemical or petroleum refinery. So a refinery typically generates multiple products like petrol, diesel, jet fuel, lube oil, and more. So the question is, whatever the emissions that are generated from the refinery and the impacts because of that, how should those be divided between these multiple products? Another relevant situation is from agriculture. Agriculture also often generates multiple products. So there is a main product, which is the crop, but there are also side products, or what we call as byproducts. And I have taken here the example of sugarcane farming. So sugarcane farming generates sugarcane, which is sent to sugar mill, but it also generates trash, which can be used for other profitable purposes. The sugar mill itself generates three products typically. You have sugar, which is the main product, but you also have bagasse, which can be used for power generation or heat generation, and you also get molasses, which is used typically for ethanol production. So again, you have a situation where a single unit process or product system is generating multiple products. You may also have a similar situation in electronics manufacturing, where the same facility is being used to produce multiple products, like two different models of a mobile phone or a tablet PC and so on. So the main question that we want to address here is, all these unit processes or product systems will have certain inventory and therefore impacts. So the question is, should these impacts be divided between these products? And if yes, what should be the basis of this division, or how should we divide these products? And that is what we want to answer and understand how LCA approaches this division. Let me start by giving a couple of real life examples. So let us say there are two individuals having a meal in a restaurant, and at the end of the meal, you get a bill for the food that you have eaten. So the question is, how should this bill be divided between the two individuals? Now, what we commonly do is that we divide it equally. So if there are two individuals, we do a 50-50 division. But one can also argue that that is not a very fair distribution. And in fact, the distribution or the division should be based on the quantity of food eaten. So strictly speaking, we should keep a track of how much food each of the individual has eaten. And then the bill should be divided based on the quantity of food eaten. Another example is sharing a taxi. So let's say there are two people sharing a taxi to the train station. And again, at the end of the journey, they will get a bill. And the question is, how should this bill be divided? So just like in the first case, you can have an equal distribution of the bill. But you can also say that the division should be based on the weight of the individual and his or her luggage. So if the total weight of the individual plus the luggage is more, maybe that person should pay more, because that individual occupied more space in the vehicle. We can also say that we can divide it based on the person who needs the taxi more urgently. So if one individual has a train which is sooner than the other individual, then you can say that it is more important for this person to take the taxi and reach the train station on time. So there are different ways you can address this problem, and we deal with these issues on a day-to-day basis. But when we solve an LCA problem, we need a systematic and formalized method of doing this division. And that is what I will discuss in the rest of the module. So I'm taking a very simple case. Let's assume that there is a product system which has two inputs, A and B. And more importantly, there are two outputs. P is the main product, let's say, and Q is a byproduct or a side product. And the information we have is that this whole product system generates an emission, CO2 emission of 150 kgs. So the question that we have to answer is, how should this 150 kg emission be divided between these two products? Should it be 75 kg for P and 75 kg for Q? Should it be 150 for P and 150 for Q? That will certainly not be correct. So how should this division happen? So in the LCA approach, in the LCA methodology, there are two approaches that are proposed to address this problem. One is the partitioning approach or partitioning method. Second is the displacement approach. And I will discuss each of these approaches in detail in the subsequent slides. Let us start by looking at the allocation by partitioning method. So here what you do is you divide the total impact using some kind of an attribute of the outputs that are generated. So in this case P and Q, and the three very commonly used attributes are mass, so division based on mass, this is known as physical allocation. Second approach is division based on money, this is known as economic allocation. And third is division based on energy, which is known as energy based allocation. So this third option is relevant only if all your products are energy products like petrol, diesel, jet fuel and so on. But let us look at the other two cases using this example. So this is the same example, but now I have given you some more information. So in addition to the two products P and Q, I have also given you information regarding the quantities that are generated. So P, 40 kgs of P is generated and 200 kgs of Q is generated. And the number here is the value of the product. So this is rupees per kg. So P is a more valuable product. The total, the product price is 2000 rupees per kg. Product Q is a less valuable product and the value is 100 rupees per kg. So given this information, let us see how each of these allocation approaches will work. So what happens in the physical or mass based allocation is you use mass as the basis of division. So you say that 40 kg of P is produced and 200 kgs of Q is produced. So the total output is 240 kgs. And so this is the denominator, and the mass of a particular product, in this case P, is the numerator. And this ratio is used as the basis of division. So this is the number that this is the calculation. So for example, as I said, the total mass that is generated is 240 kgs, and since P is generated, the total quantity of P generated is 40 kgs, 40 divided by 240 is the ratio, and this ratio or this fraction is used to divide the total emission of 150 kgs, and that turns out to be 25 kgs. And similarly, the other calculation, which is for Q, and that turns out to be 125 kgs. So this is the case of physical or mass based allocation. Now let us look at the second option, which is the economic allocation. Now here you use the price information, but the important thing to note here is that you are not using just the unit price, but the revenue that is generated. So it's going to be the multiplication of the unit price and the quantity. So as it is, as shown in this equation, the ratio is now the ratio of the revenue generated because of product P to the total revenue generated. So P plus Q, and whatever this ratio is multiplied by the total emission gives you the emission that is allocated to product P, and similarly for Q. So if I use this equation, this is what I get. So 2000 is the unit price of the product. So 2000 into 40. So this is the revenue generated because of P, and this is the total revenue generated because of P and Q. And this ratio or this fraction is the fraction for allocating 150 kgs to P, and that turns out to be 120 kgs. And similarly for Q. So for Q, the revenue generated is 100 rupees per kg multiplied by 200 kgs. And denominator again is the total revenue generated. So this turns out to be 30 kgs. Now what is important to note here is that as per the economic allocation, the impact is more for product P and less for product Q. In contrast, the impact, if I use mass-based allocation, the impact is more for Q and less for P. So this is just to highlight the fact that if you use two different allocation methods, your final impacts may change. As far as the partition-based allocation is concerned, there are three, and there could be more approaches also, but the more commonly used are mass-based and economic allocation approaches. There is no right or wrong approach, strictly speaking. But in general, economic allocation is more recommended. So that is more commonly used. And there are a couple of reasons for that. First is the argument that the price of a product which is used in the economic allocation captures the true value or the demand of the product. So if a product is in greater demand, then that should get more importance. And an example of this is pharmaceutical industry. If you look at a pharmaceutical industry and the processes involved in pharmaceutical industry, the final product that you generate, let's say a pharma API, is generated in very small quantities, and there could be byproducts which are generated in larger quantities, but obviously the pharma API is of a much greater value, and therefore you can make an argument that the whole reason for the existence of the facility is to produce that pharma API, and in such cases a price based allocation is more relevant. You can also make an argument that price-based allocation captures the changing preferences. So if there are three or four products, you know, today maybe product A is more valuable than product B, therefore impact is more allocated to product A. Maybe in a few years, product B is more valuable, and therefore it should get greater impact. So the price-based allocation captures these changing trends, which will not be captured in mass-based allocation. Energy-based allocation is also useful, but it is only relevant if all your products are energy products. One option that is typically followed by people doing research is that they do calculation using all the methods and then leave it up to the decision maker to use the right allocation approach or whatever is the preferred approach. So this is as far as the partition-based allocation is concerned. The second approach is the approach of displacement. Allocation by displacement. Now here the idea is to take credit for process that is displaced by a byproduct. So this is the concept of avoided impact. And let me elaborate that by giving you some additional information. So this is the same product system that we have previously looked at, which is generating two products. Now what we are seeing here is that you are generating a byproduct Q. And there is already an existing process which I am calling as product system 2, which is producing Q. So Q is a byproduct for this system, but there is already a product which there is already a system or a process that generates Q. And I am giving you information related to the emission of that product system. So here it shows that in order to generate 1 kg of Q, you have 0.5 kgs of CO2 emission. Now the argument here used is the byproduct Q that is generated by this main process will actually lead to the displacement of this process. In other words, if you are generating Q here, you don't need to have this process. And let us look at this in more detail. So in the partitioning based approach, we look at only this system boundary, which is in the red dotted line, and we divide the impact. Now in the displacement based approach, the argument is to consider a larger product system. So we consider the product system that is displaced. So what we say here is that Q, 200 kgs of Q is generated, and because this 200 kgs of Q is generated, this process now is not needed because you are getting 200 kgs as a byproduct. So the production of 200 kgs of Q using the original process is avoided. In other words, this means that this 0.5 kg of CO2 emission per kg of Q is avoided for 200 kgs. So this means that 200 into 0.5, 200 because I am generating 200 kgs and 0.5 is the emission profile of this product system, which leads to 100 kg, is avoided, and that's why I have negative 100, so minus 100. So in other words, you can say that this is sort of a avoided impact. And then the impact for production of P is going to be 150, which is the impact for the first product system, minus 100, which is the avoided impact here. So now you don't have to do any partitioning. You don't have to divide between P and Q. Instead, what you have done is you have considered the alternative process for producing Q and considered that in your product system. So you have actually expanded your system boundary, and then given that gives you the final impact that is allocated to P. Of course, this final number will depend on what is the efficiency of this process that is avoided. So this is the concept of allocation by displacement. In simple terms, the idea is to expand the system boundary and consider the processes that are displaced because of the production of the byproducts. So if you look at the ISO recommendation LCA, the displacement approach is more recommended. It's the recommended approach. The idea is to expand the system boundary and avoid partitioning. The argument is that it gives a more holistic picture of the life cycle impacts. However, there are several challenges that you have to deal with using displacement based approach. First of all, you need to know the impacts of the process that is displaced. So you need to know the inventory and the impacts for that alternative process. Second, you may have a situation where there are multiple process options available. So for example, let's say this Q that we are generating as a byproduct, if you look in the market, there are two different processes that can be used to produce Q. So the question is how this 200 will displace which one of these two processes. Will it displace 100 kg from this process or 100 kg from this process, or 200 and 0 or 0 and 200? That is not a very easy question to answer. And therefore, the displacement based approach, although is more recommended, it is also more challenging. And therefore, very commonly, especially in engineering literature, the partitioning based approach is more commonly used. Displacement based approach is used more in economic literature because there you have some information about how the products will be displaced and so on. So you have marginal cost, marginal prices and so on. So the important learning outcomes of this module are, first of all, there could be multiple products and therefore impacts need to be divided or allocated. There are two different allocation approaches, partitioning and displacement. The displacement approach is recommended by ISO, but it is also more challenging. In the partitioning approach, the economic allocation approach is more preferred. Thank you.